Well, it's time now to move into the second theme of the afternoon, exporting innovation. New Zealanders seem to be good at coming up with great ideas. There are some excellent examples of number 8 wire solutions over the decades when New Zealand's invented a clever solution. Think locally of companies like Hamilton Jet, Tate Electronics and Jade. We're generally very good at finding a niche to solve a problem. One of the challenges we face, however, is that we're not quite as good at commercialising these ideas, turning a profit from them and keeping the R&D going to keep ahead of the competition. In the exporting innovation theme, you'll hear from companies who've managed to come up with a good idea or found a niche for themselves and the journey that they have taken to get their idea to market and what they're doing to stay ahead of the competition. The first speaker, I'd like to introduce Dr. Helen Darling. She's founder and chief executive of Oratane Holdings. Now, Helen's one of the founding members of Oratane Global Limited, who pioneer commercial food origin systems and independently and scientifically certify the origins of food. And it's the type of business which is gaining more and more importance and profile in our modern world as demand soars for country or source of origin labelling and information. There's a worldwide growth, too, in country of origin labelling laws, organic, carbon-neutral, sustainable growing practices, and Oratane's well-placed to take advantage of this brave new environment. Oratane successfully developed food provenancing systems and solutions for many markets. Some of the products they're involved in are milk solids, beef, honey, wine, apples, wool fibre, coffee and olive oil. It's based in Dunedin. Oratane has an office in Washington, D.C., Helen has a PhD in public health, and she's wonderfully placed to share lessons learned on successfully exporting a service, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Welcome, Helen.
Okay, thank you. Very inspiring speakers to follow on behind from, but I hope you're going to enjoy my presentation. It's certainly, I feel in a very privileged and lucky position. I really enjoy what I do. I work with a fantastic group of people, one of whom is here today, Rebecca. We are the only people in the world doing this, as far as we know. So it is a niche service that we offer. It's also a service where we see there is no shortage of demand. And in fact, the global economic crisis has been really good for business because as money becomes tighter, people try and extend things and are economically motivated to make money where perhaps they shouldn't. We are based in Dunedin. We're based out at the Invermay campus now, and we have an office in Washington, D.C. We're a young company. We're only 4 years old, been trading for 4 years, and really quite ambitious. I think I'm probably being fairly honest when I say we're not afraid of global domination, and it's what we're going after. So without further ado, about Oratane. So what do? We work with producers to provide supply chain risk mitigation. What does that mean? It means that we work to be able to define how a product should look in market. And I'll talk more about that in a wee bit about how we actually go about the process of it. We also offer a certification of origin service. So the summary sort of slide or piece on the slide there is that we independently and scientifically certify the origin of food. But it comes from the forensic sciences, so the same technology that we use has been used for things such as explosives, anthrax, post 9/11, body parts, illicit drugs, you name it. But the same kind of technique can be applied. And why? Well, fraud, misrepresentation, contamination all hurt honest producers. What we do know is that the worldwide increase in counterfeiting of products, etc., has risen from $250 billion to about $500 billion, but it's hard to estimate because, of course, it's, you can only estimate that based on interceptions and arrests and that sort of thing. We know that consumers want to purchase with confidence, and kind of goes without saying. Origin is a really valuable commodity, and we keep hearing about NZ Inc. story, the New Zealand story, NZ Inc., etc. But what you don't find, or I've never found in my travels, is somebody taking a bottle of lovely Marlborough Sauvignon Blanc and calling it made in China. It always goes the other way around. We tend to upsize or upscale where the origin of a product is from, and origins do have different values. And brand integrity is paramount, and I've got a good story about that in a few minutes. So our clients, they all want to either add value, reduce risk, get access to market. We work with a number of very sort of positive, innovative producers here in New Zealand and also in the US. So in the introduction, Lauralee talked about the areas we work in: wine, honey, meat, dairy, seeds, etc. What it means is I have to do quite a lot of travel and do things like go to Kona and drink Hawaiian coffee, because the Hawaiian coffee is worth so much more than other coffee. And there's sort of hardships that I've learnt to deal with, but it's sort of part of the job, really. The character in the beside the grapes is Antonio Pasquale, a viticulturist from down in the Waitaki Valley, and the couple out in the field is one of our science staff and Peter Falloon, who's an asparagus grower here in Canterbury. And why are we needed? Well, there's a lot of devious characters around, and I don't know if people recognise this particular group, but these are the San Lu executive. So a couple of them were executed in response to the San Lu melamine disaster catastrophe, and others are serving life in prison. And this is why we're needed, because there are people out there who actually want to be able to feed their children without killing them, which is, you know, sort of basic human nature, really. We want to know that the food that we're putting in our mouth is safe. Now, sometimes that safety is determined by where it's originated from and about the transparency in the supply chain. Just a moment on melamine, because I think it's quite a fascinating story, really. It wasn't new when it came up with San Lu. In fact, it's been recycled throughout the supply chain, and it's most likely it'll keep cropping up with no pun intended. But there's a particular little quote there that possibly reflects a difference in culture and a difference in belief about food and transparency and what we should be eating, from the New York Times, where the general manager of a chemical company stated, "Melamine is mainly used in the chemical industry, but it can also be used in making cakes." He was quite specific about the making cakes, but it shows it's a toxic thing to put into a food product. What it does is when you add melamine to something, it makes the nitrogen profile look different, which makes it look like it's got more protein, which means it's worth more. So whether that's into your wheat products, whether it's into your dog food, whether it's into your pig food or your baby food, it's economic motivation. And really, the kind of motivation for the work that we do is in response to manipulation of food. And this is actually just a nice little infographic, I guess, of some of the different reasons, and they're worth spending a moment on. On the top, we've got substitution of ingredients, and here the melamine one is an obvious example. But it can also be reconstituted fruit juice for freshly squeezed and that sort of thing. Falsified packaging and labelling is where there was a case just last week in China where another dairy company was prosecuted for altering the use-by dates on products. Labelling to avoid import tax or inspection. Again, there have been some very interesting and pertinent cases, and I have an example in a moment about honey and avoiding anti-dumping tariffs from the US. Up labelling to draw a higher price. Again, this is the kind of area that things like organics come into, sustainably produced products, carbon zero. Anything that adds value to a product is likely to be copied or misrepresented. Product substitution and species swapping. The stats show that something like 30% of seafood in the US is actually mislabeled. So it might be the claim is that it's wild Atlantic salmon when in fact it's farm-raised, or it's catfish from the US when actually it's catfish from Vietnam, that sort of thing. And of course, we top the list because kiwifruit in particular is one of the most counterfeited brands. And this is a fairly old now report from the OECD, 2007. And the bit I've pulled out says, "Counterfeiting and tampering can undermine consumer trust in the quality and safety of a branded food product, leading to a loss in market share. Processors can also be fooled into buying fake ingredients for their products, further endangering the quality of their brand." Fairly early on in terms of our company, when we were a little bit naive, we possibly still are, we worked for a large company based in China that was processing milk products into infant formula. The work that we did for them, because they wanted to know that the raw ingredients they were putting into their infant formula was true, saved them $50 million US in the first year. Where our naivety came in was we weren't working on a percentage basis, so we were probably underselling ourselves considerably. But it was a really good, lesson about how people want to know that before they put something into their own branded product, that those raw ingredients are actually true to what they should be. The other thing about this OECD report, which was really fascinating, was the authors said that it doesn't matter what you put on a product, you're actually just putting a speed bump in the road for a counterfeiter. So the more you add to a product, the more you add to its value, and the more you add to the likelihood of it being copied. It's fun, this world that we live in. I put this up because it shows a nice differential and one of the reasons why there is an economic motivation. Things like garlic, I think, is the first category there. New Zealand garlic is worth considerably more than Chinese garlic. But if you look at a clove of garlic, and it looks like a clove of garlic. Onward. I apologise for people who have seen this before, but it's a fantastic story. It also has a little, shows Australia in a slightly poor light, but anyway. What happened in 2000-2001 is Australia had a dreadful drought. Honey production dropped off considerably. At the same time, the US had imposed anti-dumping tariffs on Chinese honey. The same year, interestingly, Singapore became the fourth largest exporter of honey in the world, which for anybody who's been to Singapore, you will have noticed there are no beehives in Singapore. So it was fairly obvious what was actually happening. The honey was coming from China, moving to Singapore, when it was then shipped down to Australia. For some reason, the Australian authorities never kind of went, well, why is this happening? When the honey got to Australia, it was put in drums with Made in Australia on the outside. It was then shipped up to the US, and that would have been okay, except for the honey contained chloramphenicol, which is an antibiotic. It crosses the blood-brain barrier and is great if you're having brain surgery, but it's not really good to give it to your children, and it's not good on your toast. The US tried to withdraw as much as they could from the market, but a lot of it had already gone into food production and food supply. The interesting thing that happened is that in about 2001, for some reason around the world, honey prices went up in value, or honey went up in value. These data are from the FAO. And what it shows is Australia in the green and gold down the bottom, tracking along quite nicely until 2001. New Zealand's honey price in 2001 went up. We also, when we looked at other countries, it was a phenomenon around the world that for some reason honey value went up. The fascinating thing is Australian honey is now worth less than Chinese honey. So I think it's a fairly salient lesson that the damage can be long-lasting and quite catastrophic. So what do? We work with our producers and we look at their production area. And depending on what the product is, it's a very simple sort of concept, really. We are what we eat. So cow will eat the grass. That grass will impart a unique geographical signal into the meat or to the milk, which if you know what it is, you can map it and you can say that meat came from that farm, that apple came from that orchard, etc. The fruit on our table, on your tables, for example, we could track where that actual fruit came from without looking at any of the stickers on it. So it links food back to its region of origin. We don't work in competition with traceability systems. We add, a level of insurance to them. A traceability system measures from point to point and is only as good as the weakest link. There are a lot of motivators to, create some weak links in those chains. So what we do, doesn't matter how something got to market, doesn't matter how it got to your table, we can actually look at it and compare it with reference data and say if it's truly, you know, an apple from Central Otago, an apple from Hawke's Bay. So probably now to get around to the export part of what we do, we are a young company, but from day one we realised we had to be global because our customers were going to be people who were actually going across borders. They weren't going to be domestically producing, they were going to be exporting. So we needed from day one to start with a model of service delivery really that could allow scale, that could be credible in the international marketplace, and that could really meet the needs of our customers. And we've done that in a couple of different ways. We've built what we call strategic alliances with groups that are working internationally. So for example, we work with one company that that works in risk mitigation in around 47 countries. So if we need to intercept a product in Brazil, they can intercept a product for us, send it back here and we can test it, or we can send it to a partner laboratory overseas. We also need to be internationally recognised. And we've done that in a number of different ways, and probably one of the most sort of interesting things that we've done is set up an international science board. So we have a science board that's made up of the key scientists in this field around the world, and they contribute to our best practices of what we do. But really the thing is that the solutions that we offer have to be able to cross borders. This, it's difficult to read, but this is just from the FAO, from the United Nations, and it looks at whole milk powder and exports in 2009. And you can see that the solution that we do can actually work in all countries regardless of language, IT, barriers, motivation, etc. International Science Board I've spoken about, our work has to stand up in court. So everything we do, we follow chain of custody, etc., could stand up in a court and has been tested in international court through members of our science team. Just two very, very quick case studies of exporters. This first one, Aspara Seeds down close to Lincoln. Peter Falloon produces, and I didn't know this, but we produce the best asparagus seed in the world. His problem is that if you look at an asparagus seed, it looks like a seed. And it doesn't come with a barcode, doesn't come with a tag, you can't tell where it's from. However, we can. Peter's concern is that his seed is taken overseas, is grown, and the yield is only 70% of the F1 seed. And how can you differentiate? We've been working with Peter for a couple of years, and what we've found, and I won't talk in detail about this, is that there is really clear differentiation. So in this example, you can see the Canterbury seeds are all of, seed samples rather, are all of the green triangles. The blue triangles were seeds that we sourced from asparagus growing regions in California. And the red one was an unknown sample. Peter was made aware that there were seeds for sale with his, under his name in England, and which was interesting because he didn't actually have an outlet or an agent there. So we got a sample of that seed, brought it back, and we tested it. We were able to determine that it was actually grown from Canterbury in the Canterbury region. Peter was able to sort of then look at his suppliers and ask a few very probing questions and also look at his proprietary rights, I think, around his seed. Another very quick case study. This is actually comparing dairy milk, different dairy products rather. The blue splodges are goat milk. The red is New Zealand cow milk, and the green rather is international cow milk. And really, I've just put this up, that the graph itself doesn't truly represent the difference, but what it does show is that you can actually clearly differentiate in milk products. So, just by way of example. I think that's about it. I know we're short of time, so thank you.